spirit of getting together after a year of not recording was remarkable. You could feel it in the room. Everybody was happy. Everybody was safe. We wore masks. We did our social distancing thing. And I know this was unusual. We did some new things. We're using Zoom. We use GoPro. There were some people that couldn't be in the room. And the video is a little different this time. You know, we're using Zoom. We're doing it socially distancing. So it's a new experience. I hope you enjoy it.
The idea for this is just kind of like make it more of a open discussion. This is a pretty interesting group here.
Ooh. Yeah.
As they say, it's eclectic.
That's good.
Eclectic. Is that the word? So let's talk about the track. Why the heck did you pick this one?
As far as young Americans, you know, over the last 10 years, a couple times, you know, we always get email or people that follow In the Pocket send suggestions. There's always some young Americans. You know, my response has always been, but David Bowie's British and but then they always bring up, well, you know, it was recorded at Sigma Sound. Really, it was a pretty dramatic change sound-wise in his whole direction. I mean, look, I'm a huge David Bowie fan. I love that record. I saw those shows. I snuck into those shows at the Tower.
Did any other guys ever see him in Philly perform?
Yeah, Park Stadium, yeah. Sirius Moonlight Tour.
A few times, yeah.
I call Sirius Moonlight Tour also.
Yeah, I saw that as well.
I saw a bunch of them. I saw the Ziggy Stardust at the Tower.
Ah.
In fact, I got there a little late.
Yeah.
First band was on. I went to my seats. Mm. There were people in my seats.
Yeah.
And I said, here, I have the tickets. And they said, here, we have the tickets.
Ah.
They had printed up double tickets.
Wow.
So evidently we were the only ones that had duplicates. And they said, just wait till the first act is done. So after that, they set up a row of folding chairs in front of the first row. I was like dead center in front of the first row.
I think the Tower show was my third concert, and I had never in my life seen anything like that. I mean, anybody who was there, I remember he had an outfit put on that had Velcro, I guess, going down the front and the back. And two of the players came over and just ripped the outfit off.
Oh, yeah.
And they had something else on. Oh, my gosh. It was amazing. Yeah.
Richard, what was it like for you to attempt to channel that vocal?
Well, that's a really...
He killed it.
Singular,
he was amazing.
Singular vocal. I mean, it's, you know, you can't, there's not a whole lot of ways to approach that song other than roadmap there.
Wow.
And I just wanted to be true to it, but I didn't want to do an imitation because I think that this, you know, it's just cheap and not fun. No one wants to hear that really.
Richard did an incredible job at it. And what he says is so true because, I mean, he was like referencing the original, not to imitate it, but to get the motivation from it.
Wasn't
like, oh, I want to do what he's doing. It was like, no, I want to capture that emotion, that energy, and make sure that it's delivered because the emotion of that song, it's almost deceptive. You listen to it and you feel it, but while we were recording it time and time again, we were just going, this is not easy. You know, it's like it's six measures and seven measures and four measures. The arrangement is elaborate.
Yeah. But
really listen to it. It adds to that sense of energy and that sense of just pure, you know, motivation. It was really cool. And again, I was so, you know, Richard's, he puts all of himself into everything, but to use that motivation and to see him channeling that vibe into what he does.
Yeah.
It was really special.
She was a young American, all the way from Washington. The breadwinner begs off the bathroom floor. We live for just these 20 years. Do we have to die for the 50 more years?
I think nobody knew the song better than Richard. Like, Richard knew the song better than anybody, enough to come out during the crown vocals, which were happening. And he was totally psyched, vibing, and orchestrating and conducting or hinting at what he really wanted to feel and hear in order to do the lead vocal at the same time. I thought that was awesome. Your energy coming out to us. I've never seen that side of you, Richard, where you just come out and go like, no, I'll need this. You know?
It was really great to watch.
Yeah. And he totally inspired us singing, because otherwise we would not have been able to pull off what we were trying to pull off without the nice
guys. That background vocals, I mean, really, it's like, I hoped it would be great, but boy, I that was the one thing that I was most concerned about. It's like, how are these background vocals gonna, how's
I've
this gonna transmit? And
I've
it was amazing.
I've never seen anybody do background vocals like that before. It was,
it was tricky.
In my mind.
Yeah. What was unique about it? I wasn't there. What was unique about it?
Just the group was so, it was like maybe over, because they know each other now from the years playing together, but it was like they've been a band, as if they've been working together forever, which was really remarkable.
In the true spirit of In the Pocket, you know, we were doing gang group vocals, you know, doubling vocals, you know, live, which normally these days, everybody cuts your part and makes sure it's all perfect. And we're there, you know, like, and just trying our damnedest, all standing next to each other, getting, you know, hitting the best version of it, each part that we were throwing down there. So it was old school in the best possible way.
What's great, what I heard in the background vocals was, I love the fact that I could really hear the distinctive different voices. Thank you, Phil. It was all that mic placement, Phil. But you could really hear the distinctive voices, and it worked great.
Young American, she was a young American all night.
Instrument-wise, was there anything you guys did with your setup to try to mock the sound or pay homage to the sound?
I was probably using what they used back then. It was just a Fender-style bass and same strings I always use, which are more like flat wound, so it's excuse me, it's kind of old school, you know, not twangy or anything, perfect for doing a soul record.
The guitar stuff was fascinating to me, just being, you know, I was focused on the drumming, but I love the interaction between Steve and Cliff.
I brought like four phase pedals so we could figure out the best one for Steve to do the phase part in the middle.
Yeah.
The guitar parts, the only thing that was a little strange is that usually guitar players don't play in B-flat. We try to avoid the flat keys as much as possible. So we were tuning our guitar. We were actually tuning our guitars up and down a half step just to kind of lock in to get the right key. But it was fun.
There is a gliss at the beginning of the song, which in the key of C, you just run your thumbnail down the whole keyboard, which we couldn't do because we were in B flat. So I had to use a little technology. I had to transpose the keyboard to that key. So therefore, I could use the white notes and just gliss all the way down the keyboard.
A funny thing, am I still too young? He kissed her then and there. She took his ring, took his babies. It took him in, it took him nowhere. Heaven knows she'd have taken anything. She was a young American. As he passes a boat Mustang, heaven forbid she take anything but the freak and his step up for nothing. Misses his step and cuts his hand, showing up then he swoops like a sound. She cries, where have all Papa's heroes gone? All night, she wants a young American.
Session to me seemed to zoom by. It felt like we cut the tracks.
Yeah,
and it was free from the get-go. It felt good to me.
I think a lot of it too, Dave, is I can't think of one in the pocket session that didn't do that. You know what I mean? They always, there's always a magic that's there. It comes from different places, but it always exists. And it seems like, you know, everyone, we always, as soon as it's done, we go,
yeah,
this is the best one yet. Yeah. And that just, it just blossoms, you know, yeah, every yeah. time.
Yeah.
So, and that's, I think, why it was so true to the original, because I'm sure when they cut the original, sure, they were in the studio and I'm sure they worked on parts and it was a yeah. process,
right.
but it was definitely at the time where you got in the room and you made magic.
Right.
And not that that's the only way to do it, but that's how we do it. And I yeah. think that's why it was yeah. so analogous to how it was originally created too.
And I might add, as soon as I started hearing Jay play the sax, it was oh, yeah. like I felt like my adrenaline yeah my adrenaline just went like through the roof.
1964, 10 years before this record was cut, I touched an alto saxophone for the first time, and I played it all through college, which is where I was in 74 when the record was made. When I heard the song, it was like, oh, that's Sanborn. I went, who's singing? So I came from the
other angle. Sing it. Oh, that's great.
And it was a little weird sticking it in B flat, which is traditionally a horn key, all day, every day. But it stopped being a horn key when saxophones started playing in rock and roll, and we played in the guitar keys. It's a little bit of a mind twist, because it's not, you don't just capo down, you know, you don't just fret down and go to town.
Yeah.
It's everything's in a different place. But I'm really happy with the way it turned out.
Do you remember your President Nixon? Do you remember the bills you had to pay?
Let's talk about the recording of this one. How was this different than the other ones we've done?
The whole COVID thing, you know, it on some level, it made us so much, instead of pulling us apart, it made us so much closer, because we had missed it so much.
Yeah.
And to get together and to be able to do something, even with a mask on or what, it was the first session I had done in months and months and months of that, any level, really.
I was just going to say, it's a testament to everybody. Everybody came with their mask on. Everybody was safe. Everybody stayed away from each other. And even, you know, to that point, this whole video is so different because we didn't have Steve.
Yeah, which was sad.
Steve has been doing every single video since the beginning. I think this would be the 21st song.
Wow.
And so it was amazing that he wasn't there. And if we can pull this off without Steve, it was Howard Pitkow. Thank you so much, Howard Pitkow, for being there.
Yeah.
And myself, and Phil Frechie came in and shot some footage. And so basically what you're seeing is what the three of us shot, and what Steve is beautifully editing to make it look like something.
And I think we learned some things, you know? I mean, that was something
Absolutely.
That it's tough to, it's, look, you know, the one thing about In the Pocket and a group like this is like scheduling and everybody together, but, and Steve is super busy with his business. Sometimes it's really hard to make that commitment. But hey, GoPro, video, phones, there's some things that you can do and learn from it.
And look at how we're doing the interview part.
Right.
So it's just another special piece of In the Pocket.
I'm good with everybody. Thanks, guys.
Thank
see
you.
See you.
See you.
See you, everybody.
Take care.
Bye, see you, everybody.
Bye.